I will present the topic Metabolic Transformation, Ketosis during long-term fasting. Humans had to survive situations of food shortage during their evolutionary history. Thereby, the metabolic switch ensures a constant energy supply. It is thus an elementary ability to live from the body's own reserves in the times of food shortage. In the eating state, the body burns mainly glucose for energy production. During fasting, the metabolism switches from glucose burning to ketosis, thereby using mainly fat and ketone bodies. The reintroduction of food leads to the switch back of the metabolism. This is followed by a regeneration phase. This change, the switching back and forth of the metabolism, is called metabolic flexibility. Today's lifestyle limits our metabolic flexibility due to overeating, missing meal breaks, and too little exercise. In the post-absorptive phase, after the cessation of food intake, energy is initially provided by glucose from the glycogen stores in the muscle and liver. However, these energy stores are depleted relatively quickly. Blood glucose and insulin levels drop while lipolysis starts. Now, the fat tissue releases more free fatty acids and glycerol. Free fatty acids can be used directly as energy substrate or are converted to the ketone bodies in the liver. Rapidly available proteins are transitionally used for gluconeogenesis. The metabolic switch takes about 12 to 36 hours and depends on glycogen stores and individual energy expenditure, for example through exercise. Several signaling pathways are affected by the metabolic switch. Nutrient deficiency leads to downregulation of the mTOR pathway. The energy deficit activates AMP-kinases and sirtuins. This causes multiple systemic effects such as improving cell survival, increasing stress resistance, autophagy, mitophagy, mitochondrial function, antioxidant capacity, and DNA repair. The synthesis of ketone bodies, known as ketogenesis, occurs from acetyl-CoA in the mitochondrial matrix of the liver. In this process, the ketone bodies, acetoacetate and beta-hydroxybutyrate, are formed. Spontaneous decarboxylation of acetoacetate produces the volatile acetone, which is responsible for the typical fruity smell of the breath in fasting patients. Acetoacetate and beta-hydroxybutyrate are water-soluble and pass the blood-brain barrier by facilitated diffusion. In peripheral tissues, they are degraded in mitochondria via the citric acid cycle. Under normal conditions, the concentration of ketone bodies in the blood is very low, with beta-hydroxybutyrate predominating at about 85%. During fasting, ketone body levels rise to values of up to 7 to 9 millimolar. Beta-hydroxybutyrate is not only an energy supplier. It has been shown to have numerous positive effects in cell and animal models. It leads to satiety, improves cognitive abilities such as learning and memory. It protects neurons, promotes plasticity, and decreases neuroinflammation and neurodegeneration. In addition, beta-hydroxybutyrate modifies gene expression through beta-hydroxybutylation and reduction of histone deacetylation, so that the protection against oxidative stress is increased, inflammation is inhibited, and mitochondrial biogenesis is increased. Overall, beta-hydroxybutyrate leads to anti-aging effects and positively influences longevity.
Auf die Langlebigkeit auswirken. Im klinischen Alltag können die Ketonkörper mit
For everyday clinical practice, there are two measurement methods that can be easily performed. First, ketonuria can be tested using urine test strips. The nitroprusside reaction is a semi-quantitative detection for acetoacetate in urine. Statements about the level of ketosis are limited because a color change only indicates different categories from traces to high levels. The second feasible method is the measurement of ketonemia in capillary blood. For this purpose, beta-hydroxybutyrate is detected qualitatively.
Nachweis des beta-hydroxybutyrats.
We used the two measurement methods within the scope of a clinical trial. 16 men and 16 women between the age of 20 and 70 years fasted for 12 days. The left graph shows the increase in ketonuria and the right graph shows the increase in ketonemia. We then performed a correlation analysis to see if there was a relationship between ketonuria and ketonemia. A significant, medium-strong, positive linear correlation was demonstrated. This means that a certain comparability between the two measurement methods is given. As shown at the beginning, we were able to demonstrate the metabolic switch to fasting metabolism. Parallel to the increase of ketone bodies in the blood, we found a decrease of glucose levels to the lower norm range and the decrease of insulin levels. Furthermore, triglycerides and cholesterol levels decreased. In this slide, you see the changes in ketonuria in a large cohort of 1,610 subjects. The subjects fasted for up to 21 days. It is noticeable that the intensity of ketonuria is very individual. On the one hand, there are persons who excrete hardly any ketone bodies. This is represented by the light red shades. On the other hand, there are persons who excrete very high amounts of ketone bodies. These are shown in the heat map in dark red. Black means that no measured values were available due to the different fasting lengths of the participants. The subjects can be clustered in two groups by means of hierarchical clustering. One group with persons who have low ketonuria and the other group with persons who have high ketonuria. In the group with low ketonuria, predominantly traces of ketone bodies are detected in the urine during the fasting process, which are shown here in yellow. In addition, there is a rather slow transition to higher excretion rates. In contrast, a rapid increase in ketonuria is observed in the high ketonuria group. The majority of this group excretes large amounts of ketone bodies during fasting, shown here in purple. We also see in this graph the switch back of ketosis excretion along with the reintroduction of food. One question now arises: why do these two groups exist? Therefore, we have tested the influence of the fasting supplements. Buchinger Wilhelmi offers fasting supplements during long-term fasting. These include 250 ml of fruit juice, 250 ml of soup, and about 20 g of honey. It is possible to replace the juice with a second soup and omit the honey. We have now analyzed the effect of taking the fasting supplements on ketonuria the following day. This is shown here for the second, third and fourth fasting days. In the contingency tables, you can find the number of subjects depending on the level of ketonuria from small traces to large amounts and whether the fasting supplement was taken or not. We found that ketonuria was lower the following day in subjects who consumed honey and juice. However, ketosis was still detectable. Consumption of soup had no effect on ketonuria.
Auf die Höhe der Ketonurie.
Next, we tested the influence of physiological factors on ketonuria. For this purpose, a machine learning method was used. The strongest factor that influenced ketonuria was age. This was followed by baseline levels of urea, C-reactive protein, and HDL cholesterol. In conclusion, individuals with high ketonuria were found to be younger and to have lower urea and HDL levels and higher CRP levels. The question now is whether long-term fasting has different effects in the two groups. We have indeed found differences between the groups. A greater reduction in abdominal circumference and weight was observed with high ketonuria. Uric acid increased more, whereas urea was reduced less. In addition, glucose and glycated hemoglobin levels were reduced to a greater extent. Overall, the metabolic effects of fasting appear to be more pronounced in the high ketonuria group, independent of fasting length and age. I would like to share a final observation with you. Uric acid is known to increase during fasting, as can be seen here impressively in the 32 subjects. In addition, we had just seen that a stronger increase was detected in the group with high ketonuria. In a correlation analysis, we were able to demonstrate a high positive correlation between uric acid and ketonemia. This is due to the fact that uric acid and ketone bodies are excreted by the same transporters in the kidney. The ketone bodies are preferentially excreted, resulting in a competitive inhibition of uric acid excretion and thus an increase in uric acid in the blood. Dr. Wilhelmi will now explain why uric acid and ketosis are important for our sleep.
Einflussfaktor auf unseren Schlaf haben, wird Franziska weiter erklären.